You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Gene Johnson. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com. And streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Rizzoli and Isles After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Rizzoli and Isles After Show.
Hey, what's up, guys? Bing is for doing, and what are we doing? We are doing another AfterBuzz TV Rizzoli and Isles After Show. We're on Season 3, Episode 7, Crazy for You, and Holy Crazy Intense Episode.
And crazy for us.
Seriously. I don't even know how to start, because that was a lot.
I actually almost cried.
I think there were some tears in the room tonight.
I almost cried. I was like, no makeup, please.
I had chills, like, several times throughout the show.
It was pretty intense. Before we get into the death of Dr. Parkers, let me introduce my fabulous co-hosts.
I'm Roqui Theus.
I'm Jenifer Golden.
We're happy to have you guys.
Thanks.
Okay. The death of Dr. Parkers. The first scene was totally intense.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Without getting into all of the drama of how it unfolds. The first scene was totally intense.
It was definitely intense, but what was weird was it was such a normal crime almost, or a normal killing, a homicide that wasn't like with a gauntlet or in the garbage can with a mask on and, you know, a weird creepy party. But it was just very much like you get shot and you get shot and that's the end of that.
Oh yeah, your everyday murder, no big deal.
It seems like the total normal break-in double homicide.
Right. But then they throw us.
And you knew going in, they were both doctors. They were married. They were husband and wife. Mm-hmm. So they showed us that right off the get-go. And as the team comes in and gets the call, we find out that the wife, Eve, is probably one of the most hated doctors in the world.
Yes, yeah. Because she is an advocate for not breeding in a marriage.
Childless marriages.
Right.
I don't understand.
Different? Well.
Different, and you know, everyone is freedom of speech. You're entitled to
each his own.
Right, exactly. And there are people for things, against things, and for things you wouldn't even think people would be for. You know, I mean, it's just like take a stand, and they do it. She started a whole website and a campaign. Like,
she had books with creepy names.
Right.
Yeah. Like, what is
it? No womb for children.
Right.
Yes.
That's creepy.
And one about breeding.
And clever.
I mean, but creepy.
Definitely creepy. But also, how about, like, I mean, her interview was like, you have the option to vote if you want to. You have the option to breed if you want to. I mean, voting's a little different.
But you do. I mean, they are both your choice.
Right.
And they were showing all the studies of childless marriages and saying that marriages were actually more successful with children than not. And it was just really interesting that this is how she basically lives her life. And the first person, of course, the first suspect is a crazy blogger. With 9 children, who brings all of her children to the police station.
With 9 children and no shame, because she definitely lifted her shirt up.
She did.
She did. Like, all of her womb glory.
Poor Corsac tonight was just like, really?
It was like woman central.
Hilarious.
But, and her blog was called WAC. What was a woman against?
I don't remember what the WAC stood for.
No, neither do I, but
Women Against Conceive.
I don't know.
She had a picture of Dr. Eve with a bullet target on her face.
Which automatically made her a suspect. Like,
I mean,
looks like you want to shoot Dr. Eve.
Right.
Come on, wouldn't you? I mean, if you had that picture on your website of someone and they ended up dead, I mean, that'd be the first person I would go to, too.
But then, of course, we saw that the killer was a man.
See, you thought that initially. I didn't.
You didn't?
No.
Oh, I did.
Oh, I totally
did. He definitely looked like a man when he came in.
I didn't pin that at all. Like, didn't see, I just saw black and lights being switched on, and poor Eve came out from the bathroom.
I know.
Bad time to
Bad time. And she got shot, and she yelled for her husband who came out, and then he got shot, but he tried to fight, and that was just, I mean, sad. I remember you saying,
that
like, oh, poor
heart.
Husband, because you just saw your wife get killed, and then, of course, he got killed.
And then what's your hope?
But also, by the way, remember when they showed her the woman with the target, the crazy woman with the 9 kids? We'll just call her crazy for now. But I said, I'm like, nope, it's never the first person they think
You did.
Yes.
I'm and starting to figure even, them out.
It's not even that she had the 9 kids that made her crazy. It was the blogging. And the, like, she didn't
extremist
just blog.
Nature.
She updated every single thing she did all day.
She's very passionate.
Like, I thought I was bad on Twitter. She puts me to shame.
Right. Oh, and you called out. You're like,
oh, yeah.
Angie.
I was like, well, what is she? Angie's describing herself, because she said she tells her viewers or her followers everything she's doing all day, like daytime, nighttime.
Yeah. Angie's,
Angie's
she's a serial tweeter.
Yeah. She's a social media, you know,
goddess.
Maven,
she's a serial
if
tweeter.
You will.
The thing that I thought was the first like red flag for me was when Korsak and Frost go to the judge and they're trying to get the records of the patients, which makes the most sense in the world, because obviously he's a psychiatrist and he's working with people that have severe, I mean, we're not just talking like I'm depressed. These are like severe mentally challenged issued people, like
mostly delusional,
which is, I mean, that's a big deal. So clearly you would want to get that. And they tried to get it the first time, couldn't. So then they go to the judge and the judge is like, not only does he say no, but he tells them don't ever come back. Mm-hmm. And he's so stern.
Yes. Which we all at the same time were like, it's things up here.
Oh, yeah.
My earphones are not working. Okay.
The finger was pointed at him immediately.
Absolutely.
For me, because why would the judge not want to give the information?
Exactly. I was for sure. I was like,
you thought it was him.
He's got something to do with it.
Well, and then we find out that he's a patient.
Yes. That's why he didn't want to share the information.
Well, not only is he a patient, but his delusion or his, and I don't even want to call it a delusion because I feel like this is such a touchy subject.
Right.
And one of the things I love about the show is that they're constantly covering things that are in the news and that are happening in real life that are very, very current. And this is such a touchy subject. So I don't want to call it a delusion. I don't want to call it a problem that he has. But this judge, in order to feel like he's himself, dresses like a woman.
Yes. And he actually was saying how Dr. Parker was helping him.
Yeah.
And was, you know, making him become the person that he's more comfortable being, which is Eugenia instead of Eugene. And, you know, that just shows it's not a delusion. It's just having to cope with whatever is inside you that you can't explain on your own and walk yourself through the changes you're going through or what would make you happy. So the doctor helped. And then the doctor got killed.
Well, I wonder if he would get so comfortable to the point that he could actually practice in his crosswear, like actually go.
Be a judge.
Well, and it makes you wonder, you know, I mean, there's so many different things. Is he thinking that he's more transgender? Is he thinking that he just really is a crossdresser? There's so many, they could have went so many different directions with it. And they touched on it briefly enough to get people to talk about it, which I think is really interesting, starting that conversation. But they didn't really go deep with it.
Right.
And I felt for him so much at that moment because I just can't imagine living a life as a judge. He's a high powered man in Boston. He lives this life and every single day is a lie for him.
Right.
And he just feels like he can't be real because of who he is and what he does. And I so felt for him and I kind of wanted them to go into it a little bit more.
Yeah. It was an interesting storyline.
Like
for
he was trapped in his career almost where he couldn't be who he actually is, which led him to his career regardless. So now he's stuck being this
double
person.
Trap.
And he had to make a really important decision tonight because he had to pick between himself and his job. And he had to pick his job because Korsak said to him, you can't not allow us to find a killer and a double homicide to protect your personal life.
Right.
And I feel like that was probably a big life lesson for the judge as well, to say, you know, this is your choice. This is how you feel. This is the way you want to live your life, which is fine. No one's going to say anything, but you also can't not allow us to do our job. So that had to be a really tough place for him to be in. I felt for him a little bit tonight. So it was interesting to see them throw that in.
Yeah. You know, at the same time, though, like, he didn't want them to see the records. But the records just would show that he's a patient. When they wouldn't necessarily go through his file, for instance.
And
if they did, clearly, you know, there's HIPAA and there's all these things that it would make it so they couldn't reveal it to anybody. The only people that would know are the people on the case.
Right. Which, but I mean, he has to see them in court, so he didn't want them to know.
Right. He's still iffy about anyone seeing it.
Right.
Period. So.
It was interesting.
But he seemed enlightened.
It was heartwarming.
Right. Yeah, it was definitely a touching moment.
They kind of brought something in that's definitely a big issue and that people are definitely not talking about. And now through Rizzoli and Isles, they will. And I really like that the show does that. But in any way, shape or form, the next thing that happens is they're trying to get partial prints from the
bullets.
Which,
wait, by the way, and the bullets and the partial print machine, that whole thing that
Craig, our little country boy,
Craig Morgan brings in, that like science project is what it really looked like, which detects prints. And Rizzoli had said she couldn't find the prints on the case. And she's like, how is that possible that there are no prints on this case?
It was crazy. And they pretty much hit a brick wall with the case. Like they weren't sure, there was kind of nowhere to go because they didn't have the full print. And it was, there was nowhere for them to go. They had all these people's names and they were going to interview 200 people. And in the meantime, Rizzoli, Jane is getting all these weird texts through the entire episode.
We knew it had something to do with it.
In the beginning, I didn't. But towards the end, I think we kind of figured it out.
Well, they're at the autopsy table and she's like, another one, like your bikini Brazilian wax?
Yeah.
Like, creepy.
Don't forget to get your Brazilian wax, honey.
I'm waiting for you.
Hun, dinner's ready. Don't be late.
It was, and she would constantly respond back with, I'm not your wife.
Right.
Which was really creepy. And of course, she's at work. She comes outside and we see Dominic. And Dominic was one of the first people we met in the episode.
Yes. And he did not seem creepy or weird at all.
He was the bread guy.
Yes.
He remembered Rizzoli. Rizzoli clearly didn't remember him until he said the ciabatta story.
Right.
But he was one of the first people we met.
Yeah.
And, I mean, out of nowhere, she's in the bread truck, and the next thing, she's got a needle in her neck.
Right.
I think we kind of called it, too. We're just like, oh, yeah. She goes deeper into that truck, it's over.
Yeah. I mean, I had forgotten altogether that Jane gets kidnapped
from the preview.
Right. I just completely, like, I was like ready for whatever was coming my way tonight. Yeah. I forgot completely what was going to happen. And then you said that, and I was like, oh, it's the bread guy.
Yeah.
And it's like, poor Jane. If it's not the surgeon trying to kill her, like, she's, there's always someone after poor Jane. Like, this, and it was, tonight was traumatizing for me.
It was
completely traumatizing.
Like, she's our hero.
And he gets her and he puts her in the truck. And the first thing I noticed when she was in the bed was the heels. I was like, those are not Jane's shoes.
No, you're like, why is she wearing heels?
Of course. I was like, she's in pink high heels. The first thing that me and Jane don't agree on is I would rock some pink high heels. She was like, really?
Wait, but by the way, they were also peach and like pointy and.
Yeah. They like, weren't cute.
Not cute shoes.
The whole outfit wasn't cute. She touches on that.
Yeah, she does. She does. And it was. That was the first thing he did, was he changed her clothes. And it was also really creepy that he had the circles in his bed. That
like
he had,
did it before.
Yeah. Like he clearly was ready to
lock someone up.
Well, he had had another victim. I believe her name was Emily.
Yeah.
They said he threw acid on her face. So she was probably.
Right. And he went to jail for 8 years for stalking, for maiming, for all this stuff. So, you know, he knows his drill, I guess. And I mean, he had a camera set up in the room,
which was super creepy,
above the bed, so he could watch what was happening.
And he had been watching Jane for a while.
He talked about her, the fire escape.
From the other building across, where you could directly see into her room. And then he modeled that room after her room.
Oh. Because he has a...
I couldn't imagine.
He has, like, a delusional disorder that he will pick someone and say that they're in love with him.
Yes.
Somebody of higher status.
That Jane is in love with him.
And he creates this marriage, and the photoshopped pictures blew me away.
Yeah, they went to Hawaii for their honeymoon.
It was so creepy.
Oh, I'm surprised they didn't have, like, pictures of kids or something like that, or something else. But that was just super creepy. And it was all the same picture of her, but just cut and put in different, like, her like this.
And he mimicked her bedroom.
Right.
Like, he completely mimicked her bedroom.
Well, no, not completely. Remember, he said...
Only the bottom.
He said, I'm sorry, I couldn't get it perfectly.
Because he could only see...
One side.
He could only see one side, right. So he mimicked. And it was really interesting because when Frost finally realizes that he has this he bought all this computer equipment, mm-hmm. and he obviously is streaming something. So Frost, being the computer genius that he is, figures it out,
yes,
and gets in. God. And then they're all just standing there and watching her. And it was like, I can't imagine that, being that helpless, where you're seeing someone that you work with every day, that's your family, that's your best friend, that's
someone that usually solves the crimes.
Yeah, someone so tough.
Not part of the crimes. Solves the crimes.
Jane doesn't get kidnapped.
Well, yeah, she does. Well, this isn't the first time.
Right.
Unfortunately, this is not the first time that Jane.
I know, but
I mean,
she just shouldn't be
We hope
kidnapped.
She doesn't.
Yeah, she finds herself in this situation, unfortunately, more than we would like her to. But
yeah,
it's creepy. And they're sitting there and they're watching her, and they're watching him touch her, and they're watching him talk to her, and
like cuddle
they can
up next
hear
to her.
Everything.
Yes.
Oh, so creepy.
I was like, what if something really serious happens and they're just watching, and
right.
they have no way to help her? I just couldn't imagine being Maura at this point.
Who was saying, please don't let him hurt her. Please don't let him hurt her. I mean, I couldn't imagine watching that. At least they could watch her, though, which was a plus.
Yeah.
And
to know.
Could you imagine, though, if she didn't find out that there was a camera right above her? Because she gave them all of the information they
yes.
needed.
Right. So he was standing in the room on the computer, and she realized that on the computer was her.
Right.
So obviously there's a camera somewhere.
Right. She's like, please,
so,
Frost, if you, I know you're smart. Like,
right.
Yeah, it's streaming.
Well, because, I mean, it's brilliant. It's a brilliant right. way for him to break in, find out where she is, and she just starts going off where she is, what she hears, what she smells. And it's brilliant because they would have never found her.
No. Yeah. Well, I mean, like, that she was by the airport, that she smells fish, that she mm-hmm. hears water, you know, all of that. It's genius. What it makes you think about is, what would you do if you got kidnapped?
Exactly.
You know, like,
absolutely.
Like, if you only thought like a detective while that was happening, because she put it all together and was like,
she didn't
I can
panic.
No.
Like, you could see the panic, but she thought enough about the process and what she would need to
right.
do. And it was kind of brilliant. And at first they go to Maura's, Jane's apartment, because they think that's where she is.
Right.
And
yeah.
she's not, which I feel like all of us knew she wasn't
right.
gonna
yeah,
be
we were like, come on, guys. Really? You're
yeah.
going to go to her Jane's apartment? He's not that crazy. Well,
he was that crazy.
He
but
was
he's
that
not.
Crazy. But they do finally get to her. And I think one of the most heartwarming things in the show always is that Jane always goes to Maura.
Yeah.
She always finds Maura at the end. When the surgeon was after her in the first season, every time she needed safety, she went with Maura.
Yeah.
And Maura was very visibly shaken tonight.
Yeah.
Like, she was having a really hard time with it. And
I think she's the one who got me teary-eyed, because I could just feel her. Just, I could not imagine how a best friend would feel if they were watching their best friend tied up. And
right. And they're like sisters.
So vulnerable.
You know, it's just, it was terrible to watch her go through it, but also, like, you're rooting for her to get found.
Right.
And then
yeah.
it's like a whole lot of, and then her brother has to go on and do it. And it's just a lot.
But it was really cool. Like, the first thing Jane does, of course, is complain about the shoes and the outfit.
Oh, yeah.
Right. I love that she makes a joke, of course.
And then the most interesting line of the whole show, of course, for me, was Maura saying that she now thought that marriage wasn't an option for her
mm-hmm.
and that she was going to save her eggs, which, I mean, for me, of course, I'm going to take it completely different than you ladies are. So I'm very curious to hear your opinions before we move on. But, I mean, for me, she just saw her best friend, someone that she loves in a way, go through this traumatic experience and thinking about being without her. And now all of a sudden she's not thinking about marriage. And now all of a sudden she's thinking about babies. So for me, they just flirted with that line again, which, I mean, I'm not the only one that feels this way.
No,
you're not.
After
you're
Ellen,
not.
Thank you for supporting me every week. But, you know, it was for me, that's how I read it. And I know a lot of people will read it another way. So I'm curious to hear your opinions on her egg saving.
I mean, I just feel like that was her last option, or that was an option she felt necessary, because she's single. You know, she doesn't really know where she's going in terms of relationships. So save your eggs and see what happens.
Yeah.
Plus, it all ties back to Dr. Eve Parker, you
yeah.
know, and
mm-hmm.
and the option to breed or not. She's saying, I actually do want to breed. Don't know when it's going to happen. Don't know if there's going to be some man involved,
exactly.
because clearly Dennis has not come back.
No.
Tommy is not coming back, especially with this whole Lydia fiasco. I mean, who knows? But, you know, I think it all tied back to that and the start of the episode. So,
yeah,
it came kind of full circle there for me.
Yeah.
Not so much where you take it, but I totally get it.
Yeah, you know.
I can see it.
I have high hopes.
I can totally see where it would go with that. I don't think it's going to, but.
Before we move on to Maura and Pike, I have to tell everybody, because I thought this was so cool last night. We were on the chat roll in the other room, and we had a girl named Chloe on our chat roll. She's a big Bachelor fan. And she shared with us last night that she had a bunch of Amazon purchases to do, and she went to AfterBuzz TV and did her Amazon purchases that way. And I thought that was really cool, because we listen to your tweets. We follow you on chat roll. We definitely love when you comment on us. But it was really cool to actually see one of our listeners saying, hey, you know what? I listened. I went to AfterBuzz TV. It didn't cost me any more money. I went to my Amazon. I did my shopping. And now she helped us provide you with this great free show that you guys get to see. So thank you again, Chloe. We love you.
Thank you, Chloe.
And if you guys are buying stuff on Amazon, do it through us and then tell us about it so we can give you a little shout out on our show.
Definitely. Right? Nice. We love when people help us out. We want to help you out by giving you shout outs and answering any questions you may have, or, you know, discussing some topics you like. So,
yeah. Exactly. Pike and Maura.
Oh, Pike. Yeah.
I love that the first thing he does is fight with her. Like, he's not even in the bakery 5 seconds, and he's butting heads with Maura. And they've had this relationship for so long that they just hate each other.
Right. And I love how he goes to Rizzoli, like, oh, you look stunning today. Mm-hmm. You look tired. Like, it's just funny. And then to see how that evolves. And you're just like, oh, you were behaving like a third grade boy, but you're so old.
Well, it's funny because they're having a convention about bullets and all these. It's a symposium, the Bullet and Blast Symposium. And he brings like 13 cases and everyone else comes in with their clipboard. And he's so serious.
His swag.
I was just about to say that. What? I'm sorry. I only know one definition for the term swag.
Swag, free stuff, swag bags.
Yeah. No, that's what he had. He had things that he was giving away.
You've never heard of that? Like, if you go to, like, gifting suites, they give you swag.
Oh, not like swagger, but like.
No, I was like, swag. What do you mean swag?
Yeah.
What is it? It's
stuff we all get.
Stuff we all get. I knew it.
Okay.
Ben.
You love it. Thanks, too,
Ben.
Don't you?
So good.
Who doesn't love swag?
Welcome. Now I like swag.
Yeah, it's free stuff.
In both ways.
Yeah.
So if anybody didn't know, that's what that means.
Chef swagger and swag.
It is. And it's just interesting. So they go into the autopsy room and there's three of them. There's Pike and there's Pop Off, which all I could think of was the vodka every time they said his name.
And he was drinking vodka.
And then our country boy. but he brings out this weird vacuum, Pike, like this weird electronic going to help with the autopsy vacuum. Maura has a freak out. And she's got this thing set in her head that he's taking money to endorse this vacuum, which would be against every rule.
Right.
And we know how Maura is about rules.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, especially since she's in competition with him. So she's like, what's going on here?
Exactly. She wanted to find any dirt she could on Pike.
Well, and ever since he said the bullet was the wrong size in that one case, which was a really big deal, like, she's never let him let that go.
Right.
And because he had to take over when she was away, there were so many different things that they just have this animosity towards each other. But from one of the events that they have for this symposium, he gets wasted.
And why is he wearing an axe on his head?
He gave them to everyone. Don't you remember? He gave one to...
Yeah, but I still don't... I think I, like, blinked or something and missed why he was wearing an axe on his head.
All I heard was him tell Maura that she should wear it because she's good at stabbing people in the back.
Right. I got that part, but I was still confused as to why he was wearing it on his head. Right. Unless it was, like, a crazy hat party.
Were there other hats, though? I think I saw other people with...
I mean, there was a cowboy hat.
Right. Craig Morgan was wearing his cowboy hat, but I think he didn't take that off the whole time.
So. No.
No, he literally had it on the whole show.
Right. Yeah. Well, he's got his roots.
He's got the accent to match.
But how great. So Long Island iced tea is
five Long Island
iced
tea.
Maybe.
That's a lot of liquor, people. Maybe I've been a bartender since I was 18. That is a lot of liquor.
And that's a that's a really strong drink.
Yeah.
And
well,
he's a
tall
man.
Five different liquors in it.
tall skinny man.
Five Long Islands.
Right.
Maybe.
Maybe, he said. Could have been more.
And professes his love.
And tries to, like, make out with her. Leans in. Oh. Is like, meh.
Mm-mm. Oh, he's been in love with her for years.
Oh, that's what he said.
And
ever since
I
something
like
that they went
through
together.
I feel like that's why there's animosity. It's like childlike.
It's a
crushes.
Cat and mouse thing, except there's no.
He just needed to sit behind her and pull her ponytail.
Exactly.
I mean,
right. Or throw rocks.
Exactly.
It's like kindergarten love.
Like, poke her.
And poor Maura, she was just like, get off.
She was horrified.
And Pop Off comes to try to save Maura and ends up in the worst fist fight I've ever seen between two grown men in my life.
Can we please?
It, I mean,
that's how they were doing.
They should have just like thrown earrings and pulled off extensions because right. It was really bad.
Or like slapped.
It was just bad.
Ugh.
And our country boy saves the day.
Of course he does.
It was kind of amazing.
It was.
He came to the rescue.
He had a very big science project prepared for them the next day.
He did.
Yeah.
Yeah, which helped them get the... It was
like a sweat.
He brought the sweat out in the bullet that made them be able to see the fingerprint.
The partial fingerprint.
Where did they come up with this?
I don't know.
It's like sweat to get a finger...
The things we learn. Now we know how crimes are solved.
I will wear gloves if I ever want to do a crime because clearly these people leave fingerprints everywhere.
Clearly.
I mean,
good to know that you won't leave prints behind.
No,
it sounds that like you now.
Yeah,
but you're
thank
saying
you for
it.
Joining the team.
I will. I will not leave any prints, especially
no, we'll be
when
smart.
I'm stealing shoes. That's what I will be stealing, shoes.
You just steal them from somebody with the same size as you.
Right.
Least.
I work for shoes stealing them.
Uh-oh.
Something like that.
We'll work for shoes.
We'll steal your shoes.
You need like a sign on the side of the road. We'll work for high heels.
Yeah. It was brilliant. But Maura and Pike, I don't think they're going to be walking down the aisle anytime soon.
Don't think so.
No. But how great when he pretended like he did not remember it even happened.
Well, maybe he really didn't.
I mean, that's possible.
He was really drunk.
That is possible.
He pretend like nothing.
That's
straight face. I'm gonna treat you like a piece of dirt again.
You haven't slept. You don't hold your alcohol well.
Clearly, you don't know how to handle your morning. It was really bad.
Right. And then to Jane, you look stunning, Jane.
Right. She does. They both do actually. But
she did.
Before we go to Lydia and family, I want to tell you guys too. I know I touched on it briefly with Amazon, but We do all come in here and do this for free, and we give you our show for free, and we have tons of fun doing it, and we love it. But we do need you guys to do one thing for us, and that's rate us. So if you guys go to iTunes, if you could do us the big favor of going to iTunes and go on and comment and rate us and give us your 5 stars, because I know you want to. It just helps us out. And if you tell a friend and they tell a friend, it's even better. And we want to keep continuing to give you guys a great show and a great after show. I mean, we have so many of them now between Bachelorette and Open Mic. I mean, there's so many of them.
Opening act, sorry.
I don't do that show, clearly.
Get it straight, Krisily.
But there's so many shows that we're able to bring you by doing this. And all we need is for you to help us out by going to iTunes. So do us a favor. Go to iTunes and give us a rate.
Leave us some comments, too.
Yeah, we like that.
We like the comments.
It's fun to read what you guys think.
The tart has shown up.
The tart is back.
Oh, tart.
People always make comebacks. You think they're gone, and then they're back.
Well, you knew she was going to come back.
We never met her.
No,
but they've talked about her so many times, so we knew eventually we were going to meet the tart.
Finally,
whose name's Lydia.
For the tart.
Mama Rizzoli is doing some guerrilla-style promotions for an espresso company.
Which is also very similar to what Pike might have been doing with that vacuum thing. So I think it's kind of funny that both of them were doing promotions.
Yeah. Well, Mama Rizzoli got a new car.
Yeah, she did.
It may have had a giant can of espresso on the top of it.
Yeah, bad one.
I love that was revealed so much later when she was, like, bragging to everyone. She's like, well, one of my coffee people gave me a car. It's a brand new Camry. It's the best car I ever got. And then you see it, and it's, like, an atrocity.
Yeah.
And, I mean, at least Red Bull did it right. They did it on a Mini Cooper, so it's this big. It's, like, pocket size.
Right.
This can was huge. A Camry's a big car.
Yes.
Yeah.
But she got it for free, and not only did she get the car for free, but she has to talk about it as she's driving, which is brilliant.
That is brilliant.
Because if anybody's going to talk about it, it's going to be Mama Rizzoli.
Right.
In that voice, just she's echoing so around Boston.
She's getting in the car to leave, and she gets rear-ended, and it was Boston people. It was not Boston bump style. Like, we all do. I mean, I lived in Boston. We call it the Boston bump. You kind of just touch and then touch and you're in. It's the Boston bump. You don't leave damage. It's just the Boston bump. She did not do the Boston bump tonight.
No, she slammed
it was more of a crash.
Right.
It was a total crash. And she was a mess.
Yeah.
Like, her purse, everything was falling out. She was crying. She was pregnant. She was complaining about she just lost her job. She just lost her friend. And
her fiance.
Then she lost her fiance.
Yes. I wonder why.
Because she's a hot mess.
Well,
I mean, clearly she's a hot mess.
We know why.
And she's there because of the parking tickets. And poor Frankie starts picking everything up and starts looking at the name. And there's Lydia.
Yes.
Lydia Sparks. What a name.
Fiance of Daddy.
Ex-fiance. I didn't expect her to look like that either.
I don't know what I thought.
She wasn't. I thought she was going to be this, like, supermodel type young.
Maybe like a playmate of some kind.
Yeah, exactly.
Bleach blonde hair, not like normal blonde hair.
Right.
And, you know, like, she looked like a regular girl.
Very, very.
Not somebody
very
that
girly and yeah. childlike almost. Just
yeah.
Well, yeah.
And I expected really to young. See the little tart coming in with the big boobs and the high heels
exactly.
and the dress too small.
Stereotype for sure.
Yeah, I
Playboy.
Thought. And this girl was nothing of the sort.
No.
She just looks sweet.
And a hot mess.
A hot
like,
mess.
She was falling apart.
I thought she was drunk for a second.
Well, and then we find out
because
well, no,
pregnant
she's
and
talking
drunk
about at the first time
oh.
when we meet her.
Right.
Like she because she was crying and it was yeah. like, what is going on? And there's obviously so much more to the story that we don't know. Mm-hmm. And Frankie immediately goes to Jane and tells Jane, like, I just met Lydia.
Yep.
And she's pregnant.
Yeah.
And not with Dad.
And then she's mad at Dad. She's like, what is he doing? Is he going through some kind of midlife crisis?
A late midlife crisis because he's not
crisis.
Even midlife anymore.
Right.
But, I mean, if you remember in past seasons, he's like the dad. He's the plumber. He fixes stuff.
Right.
Like, he doesn't
the
fall
good guy.
Apart and end up with the little blonde 25-year-old.
Right. Like, there's clearly something that's going on with him, which I would say in predictions we can discuss.
Yeah. And, well, she says it. She's like, do we even know who he is? Like, what's
right.
going on?
He's going to pull up in a convertible.
I know, right? Like yeah. an IROC Z.
With, like, three goddesses behind him.
Yeah. They'll be the playmates.
Right.
I love that Jane goes to Maura and Maura is the face. Like,
oh,
I'm not supposed to tell you. Mm-hmm. I'm hiding a secret. And then she tells her, which is kind of brilliant.
Which is duh. She's going to tell her.
But I mean, it's a big secret.
Yeah.
I mean, Tommy, for some reason, felt safe to tell Maura. And
right.
I mean, it's kind of creepy that your dad's marrying a girl that you've slept with.
Right.
Yeah.
And then that led us to maybe, you know, think that this child belonged to Tommy and not the father, actually.
Exactly.
Well,
I
yeah.
feel like that's why they split up. But that will be revealed later, I'm sure.
I mean, clearly she's going to have to come back because mm-hmm. she ends up at Maura's house because, of course, Mama Rizzoli feels bad for her.
Takes strays.
Goes to dinner.
Yes.
And after dinner, she starts acting like she's wasted.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they bring her to Maura's house, and Maura's standing there, and Jane's, and everyone's looking at her and saying she's clearly drunk.
Right.
Right. But this is the way she was acting when we first saw her, when we first met her in the show.
Not
episode.
To the extent, though.
No.
Not to the extent, but just
I felt
slurring
loopy.
Words.
Yeah, no, I feel like there was a really
loopy.
Big difference because when we
yeah.
first met her, she was really emotional. And crying, and this time she was slurring her words. Like
yeah.
she was not crying and emotional and upset. She was, and I as soon as it happened, I guessed it because I'm sure viewers have friends or know anyone that's diabetic, and if
mm-hmm.
you don't, that's exactly what happens. The eyes get really glossy, and the God, you think they're wasted. Like
yeah.
they're slurring and the things they're saying aren't really making sense and they're walking a little bit slow. And I never knew the having to pee part. I guess no one shared that with me.
She said that she had to pee 10 seconds.
Yeah, and she kept saying, are you thirsty? So they gave her orange juice, which is, of course, the first thing you do for a diabetic is give them orange juice because brings their sugar back up. But it was crazy because now, clearly, we're going to have to see her again.
Right,
yeah.
Cause she has a medical issue. But also, when you thought she was drunk before you knew she had diabetes, didn't you think, like, okay, of course, this girl drinks when she's pregnant. She's a
I
real
did,
hot mess.
Sure.
No wonder all this is
yeah.
going on. Like, of course.
Which is exactly what Jane was thinking.
Right.
Which was brilliant.
Right. And then you find out, like, oh, poor girl. Like,
thank God for Maura.
Right.
Because they would have just let her sleep it off.
Thank God there's a doctor in the house.
Yeah.
Maura's brilliant.
Well, and it's dangerous because they would have probably thought she was drunk and tried to let her sleep it off. And
right.
she could have went into a diabetic coma and died. So,
right.
I mean, it was a really serious
Whoa.
Issue.
Whoa.
Yeah. It was like no joke. Like not just give her orange juice. Like you have to get them to the hospital.
Yeah.
So every scenario was super intense tonight.
Very
with, like
intense.
Life or death.
How about when Frankie and Jane were saying, like, well, that could be our sibling in there, so we should probably take care of her.
Or their niece.
Right, but
it could be their little
could
brother or sister,
be.
Or it could be their niece or nephew.
Either
way, there's a relation.
There's definitely a blood relation happening there, so yeah, we'll find out for sure.
But how funny was it when Frankie leans over and she's like, you're handsome.
No,
right?
You're cute.
Way to keep it in the family.
Right?
Like,
You just clearly have a type.
Sleep with the Rizzoli.
All of
all the brothers. And maybe the sisters. I don't know.
And they had planned the family meeting, which obviously got interrupted by someone being kidnapped. But they never get to tell Mama Rizzoli. So we right. know that this is going right. to be something that will be brought up again because it's a big thing.
It is a big yes. thing. By the way, though, that talking stick was quite genius. Maybe we should get a talking stick. I think all people should have talking sticks.
I know someone who likes to use this talking stick in my house.
Uh-oh. Do you?
Because I sometimes talk over and interrupt people when they're trying to tell me serious things.
Never. Mm. You wouldn't.
I do.
No.
I don't see that.
Totally.
Talking stick it is.
Talking stick.
We'll buy one on Amazon.
Mama Rizzoli was ready to use that talking stick for many other things, which is why I love
Eating.
Her so much. So yes. much. We're going to go to a quick little commercial, and we are going to come back with Jen in News and Gossip.
Hey there, good buddies. The handle's Wooly Bear. I'm a truck driving man, but I'm not that old school kind of truck driving man. No, I like to listen to podcasts while I'm driving through these great United States of ours. And my favorite podcasts in the world are from AfterBuzz TV. And why? Because AfterBuzz TV is like a post-game wrap-up show for all your favorite TV shows, like Jersey Shore, Dancing with the Stars, Mad Men, and a whole truckload more. I like listening to my Gossip Girl podcast, catching up with all my fellow fans and getting all the latest news and gossip. No, I got some strong opinions. And AfterBuzz TV lets me share those opinions with thousands of other listeners. Woo-wee, what a feeling. I used to doze off on those lonely stretches of road. And don't worry, I got the cruise control. But now I'm wide awake and listening to all the AfterBuzz TV goodness. Check them out. Give them a holler. And tell them the old Wooly Bear sent you.
So we're back, and we have some news.
Ready.
AfterBuzz TV News.
All right. So today, everybody, it is a special day because it is our country singer Craig Morgan's birthday. He turned 48 today, and he was on our show. And we actually have Craig Morgan on the show thanks to Angie Harmon and his friendship, because she was in one of his country music videos, and so that's how they became friends.
Oh,
and
cool.
So yeah, so he went on this show because of their friendship, you know, to reciprocate the favor.
Cool.
And he's doing some more acting, and I forget what the other show is. Oh, Army Wives.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm not sure how much more we'll be seeing him, but that is a fun fact that his show aired on his birthday. Wonder what he's doing for his birthday.
He does not
Craig
look 48.
Morgan.
No,
he doesn't. Didn't last week when we were looking at pictures of him, you thought he was younger, I think.
Yeah, I thought he was much younger.
He's a young guy.
30s or...
Yeah, he looks younger in pictures, too.
Yeah.
But he was great tonight, and he was a lot of fun, and he was so country.
So country.
Loved it. Brought his hat and everything. Could have played it off, could have been anything.
Nope, so country.
Too bad he wasn't on GCB, because that was pretty country, too.
Oh, my gosh.
But anyway, so now we know why he ended up on the show and the connection there, and we wish him a happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Yay. another really awesome thing is that Sasha Alexander was voted as one of After Ellen's top 100 stars.
Yep,
stars?
Hot 100.
Hot 100. So that's pretty awesome because she is pretty hot.
Yeah, and she thanked them and tweeted them and was really super excited and thought it was an honor. And obviously, they know that there's a big, strong lesbian fan base on the show. And After Ellen supports their show every week, so it was really cool to see them nominate her, and she was really excited about it. So it was cool.
Yay, Sasha.
Good for you, girl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other news and gossip?
Lorraine Bracco was on Jimmy Fallon last night, and she reminded Jimmy that there was a time when Angie Harmon kicked his butt in beer pong.
I saw that.
Yeah. So, Angie, I feel like we should, like, play a round of beer pong sometime with her. And she seems like a really fun
yes,
lady.
Definitely.
I mean, she's going on 40 next month. And she just seems like a good time. She felt like a fun mom, fun wife. Like, she's just great.
Well, following her on Instagram shows that she's really fun.
Yeah.
I'm like, not following her on Instagram.
Oh, you are slacking
you're
off,
missing
girl.
Out.
Slacking off. She is constantly late. Showing pictures of, like, her family and, like, making
cool.
snarky faces. And she just seems like somebody you want to be friends with.
But the real question is, did she do an Instagram photo at Rockin' Riley's the other night when she and her husband were there at our local bar in West Hollywood?
Mm-hmm. Oh, fun.
They were there. I had a friend who was actually like, oh, your girl is at our show from your show. And I'm like, I mean, at our bar from your show. I'm like, who, Krisily? Roqui? And no, Angie Harmon. I was like, oh, that is my girl.
That, should we go way back?
We do go way back.
You know.
Old friends.
You know, two seasons back. Mm-hmm. So that is something awesome because that's a little bit of information we did not know. Beer pong it is. And also, Lorraine is going to be making the rounds. I think this Thursday she's going to be on Watch What Happens Live with Andy.
Nice.
Andy Cohen. And that'll then on Friday, fun. Right, she's going to be on The View.
Nice.
Right.
And I hear she's talking about cooking on some of the shows too.
She is.
Which is cool.
She's actually a cook and she cooks on the show.
So something she knows and loves.
She needs to teach me how to cook.
I know. She should actually put out a cookbook. Just saying.
Yeah.
Ooh. Mama Rizzoli's cookbook.
Rizzoli and Isles cooking.
I think so.
Nice.
So that is all of our news and gossip for the week.
Thanks, Jay.
No problem.
Which leads us to... Love that music.
And now...
Ben's so good. So good, Ben.
Predictions.
What are our predictions,
so many.
Ladies?
Extra creepy right now.
I love it. Lydia, what will happen?
We're going to find out who the baby daddy is.
Tommy's
sure.
The baby daddy.
Should we place bets right now?
I think
Should
Tommy's
we?
The baby daddy.
Okay, so we're all in agreement, I
okay,
guess.
Good.
We're either all winning or all losing.
Yeah,
exactly.
Viewers and listeners, please let us know what you think.
Yeah, who's the baby daddy? I mean.
I go Tommy.
And I feel like we're gonna see this because, first of all, Mama Rizzoli is, first of all, going to be furious. But she's also
so
going
to
want to, like, this could be her granddaughter or son, grandson. So, I
this
mean,
could
she's
so going to
want
things.
To. Lydia's going to end up part of the family, I feel like.
Yes. Yeah. They're going to take her in. Oh, yes. Absolutely.
Mama Rizzoli wouldn't let her not be a part of the family because she's pregnant.
She'd probably, like, be really.
Some motherly instinct.
Right. She'd probably be really upset first when she finds out, but then feel bad for her. Because she sort of does that thing where she, like, she does, like, the opposite sort of the emotion you would expect. And then, so I think that's what we're going to see. Which means that then Tommy or the dad may be back, which we haven't seen them in a while. So
no, I think we'll see Tommy before we'll see
baby.
The dad. Yeah,
because
he's fishing or something in South Beach. Is that what she said tonight? He was fishing.
Something random. He's always doing something weird.
Yeah, always. What about the boys? Do we think the boys are coming back? I mean, we've talked about Casey, and I mean, the creepy hand guy. Like,
I've ruled creepy hand guy out.
I think he's done. But I do think that Casey will be back. And I actually, for a minute tonight, when the texting was coming through through to Jane, I was like, maybe it's Casey and maybe he's lost his mind. I don't know. Maybe he's really
PTSD.
Reaching out to go to dinner or something. I don't know what this is, but whatever.
Wait, and last week I noticed in the episode that the hand is still on Maura's desk.
Oh, look at you.
You noticed that?
Yeah.
Look at that eye.
I'm creepy. It's totally okay. You can say it. I'm creepy. I did. The hand was still on her desk. She was sitting down, and it was like the girl, little apprentice girl came in, and it was just sitting there like the creepy hand, and I was like, ooh. But makes me feel like he's going to come back.
Yeah.
It's giving people like you who notice these things.
Super, super fans, not just regular super fans like us.
That just made me weird, huh?
Not weird. Not totally weird.
Not weird. Smart.
Any other predictions that you guys can think of that I'm not?
The mom. Hope, hello?
Oh.
I mean, yeah.
She's going to be back.
Yeah.
She's going to be back because.
Well, I mean, because. That was a big deal.
Their mom.
Yeah, and the daughter, will she take the kidney? And, I mean, that's a huge storyline.
Totally
so.
Forgot about that.
They clearly needed space tonight. So
I mean,
they were doing their thing.
Oh, yeah. Needed to get kidnapped for about 20 minutes.
Best show, though. I cried. I laughed. I got the goosebumps. And they constantly touch on all these things that are just really going on in the world. Which is
how do they stay current when they film so early? I mean,
they're just
well,
Janet's
I mean, those
brilliant.
Are those are
they have a crystal ball.
Those are issues that have been prevalent
right.
for a
they're
while.
They're big issues.
Yeah.
Not
and they're great.
Current.
And they've been doing really good.
Yeah.
Another amazing show for Rizzoli and Isles. We love the show. I can't wait till next week. I'm already ready. And I go home and watch the episode again because that's how weird I am. But tell
that's
them
why you saw the hand.
Yeah, you know, it happens. Tell them where they can find you guys.
At Roqui underscore T.
And I'm at Jen the Jew.
And you guys can follow me at Krisily on Twitter. And Jen does another after show.
Opening act, Monday night at 11 p.m. PST.
Yeah, so check her out on AfterBuzz TV then. And I do Bachelorette and Bachelor Pad on Mondays. So check us out. And we will see you next week.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principal.